A very good morning and welcome to the 24th meeting of the Criminal Justice Committee in 2023. We have apologies this morning from Pauline McNeill, and our first item of business today is our first evidence session on the Victims, Witnesses and Justice Reform Scotland Bill. We're joined by the Cabinet Secretary for Justice and Home Affairs and her officials. I welcome the Cabinet Secretary and her officials. So I welcome Anna Donald, Deputy Director of the Criminal Justice Division, Lisa McCloy, Head of Criminal Justice Reform Unit, and Nicola Guild, Solicitor with the Legal Directorate at the Scottish Government. So welcome all. And I refer members to papers 1 and 2. I intend to allow up to 2 hours for this session. But before we get underway, I want to briefly say a few words about our forthcoming scrutiny of the bill. As a committee, we're very aware that it is a major piece of legislation containing a number of significant provisions, and we're aware of our responsibility to take the time necessary to scrutinise the legislation properly in a balanced manner to hear from a range of views on the bill. And furthermore, we want to ensure that all aspects of the bill get proper scrutiny, so we have decided to take a phased approach to our scrutiny to protect time for each part of the bill. And further details of this can be found on the Scottish Parliament website. So today's session with the Cabinet Secretary is a chance for us to set the scene on the bill, to hear why the Scottish Government has brought forward these proposals. And in future weeks, we will move on to taking detailed evidence from a range of interested parties on the bill. I'd also like to acknowledge all those individuals and organisations who took the time to respond to our call for written views, and these are now published and available online. So with that, I invite the Cabinet Secretary to make a short opening statement, and then we'll move to questions. Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you very much, Convener, and good morning to colleagues. I very much appreciate the opportunity to appear before committee this morning at the start of your deliberations on the Victims, Witness and Justice Reform Bill. This is landmark legislation. It's a bill that puts victims and witnesses of crime at the heart of our justice system. It contains an ambitious package of reforms to modernise processes and improve the experience of victims and witnesses, particularly in relation to sexual offences. It does so whilst continuing to safeguard the operation of key principles of the justice system and protecting the rights of the accused. The bill draws on a wide body of evidence. It has been informed by the work of the Victims Task Force and the independent cross-sector review into the management of sexual offence cases by Lady Dorian, Scotland's second highest judge. It is informed by the groundbreaking 2019 Scottish Jury Research Study, which was led by leading academics, and it follows 2 public consultations which demonstrated broad support for the measures in this bill. Crucially, though, the bill has been shaped by survivors and victims and their families. They have told us that they often feel unheard and cannot access information, and that they do not feel safe and often do not experience compassion. The bill therefore represents a transformative approach to build a more modern, responsive, sensitive and person-centred justice system that will ensure that victims of crime are treated with compassion and that their voice is heard. Trauma-informed practice is key to this. That means making sure those working within our justice system recognise the impact of trauma on those that they deal with, and where possible, adapt processes to reduce the risk of re-traumatisation. The justice system has been widely engaged in this work, as is evidenced by the launch of the Trauma-Informed Knowledge and Skills Framework earlier this year. The bill provides a legislative underpinning for the cultural and procedural change necessary to embed this practice, and I'd briefly like to take you through the rest of the bill's measures. There is clear and compelling evidence that the not proven verdict is not well understood and can result in stigma for the acquitted and trauma for complainers. The bill will abolish the verdict to improve the fairness, clarity and transparency of decision making in criminal cases. We have carefully consulted on the other distinct features of our jury system and concluded that in a reform system with only two verdicts, a requirement of two-thirds majority for convictions is appropriate. To enhance the quality of deliberation, the bill also seeks to reduce the jury size. The bill increases protections for vulnerable parties and witnesses in civil cases by extending the use of special measures and by protecting those who have suffered abuse from being cross-examined by their abuser. It will create a commissioner who will provide an independent voice for victims and witnesses too. The bill also aims to ensure that justice meets the needs of victims and survivors of sexual offences, the majority of whom are women and girls. By addressing in a practical way the long-standing concerns about how the system operates for sexual offending. Now, as the committee knows, the challenges we face as a society to eradicate violence against women and girls are urgent and complex. Part of the solution is in making sure that we have a justice system that commands confidence. And that means a system that encourages victims to come forward, supports them to give their best evidence, and holds those who commit these offences to account. And this bill provides an opportunity to put in place significant and meaningful reform. The creation of an automatic lifelong right to anonymity will protect the dignity and privacy of victims of sexual offences. The right to publicly funded independent legal representation strengthens rights of complainers in an especially intrusive aspect of criminal procedure. The Sexual Offences Court will improve the experience of complainers through greater use of pre-recorded evidence, improve judicial case management and mandatory trauma-informed training. And the new court will also help reduce delays in cases coming to trial. The time-limited pilot of single-judge rape trials will provide evidence and inform debate on how to deliver meaningful access to justice for complainers in cases of rape. Convener, I want to ensure that victims and witnesses are at the heart of our justice system, and I would hope that the debate and discussion around this bill bears that in mind and is measured and constructive. And the undertaking I give to committee and others is that I will do everything in my contributions and in my power to ensure that we have the debate of the very highest of standards. And as always, I remain committed to working with members, partners, stakeholders and importantly, people with lived experience to ensure that this legislation achieves its aims. And I very much look forward to committee's scrutiny of the bill. Thank you.
Thank you very much indeed, Cabinet Secretary. That's a very helpful overview. So I'm now going to open up to questions, and I would ask members for the first part of our session if they could focus their questions on part four of the bill, which relates to the removal of the not proven verdict and also a change to jury size. So I wonder if I can maybe just open things up and ask a question in and around conviction rates. So there's the Cabinet Secretary has just set out a pretty wide-ranging rationale for the provisions around not proven, removing the not proven verdict and changing jury sizes, and some of that relates to the public don't really understand those aspects of trials. They potentially re-traumatise individuals. But in terms of conviction rates, I'm just interested in some more detail on the thinking in relation to how these changes might improve or change conviction rates in Scotland.
So Convener, it is very important to stress that the jury reforms are not about either increasing or decreasing conviction rates. They are about the integrity of our system, the fairness of our system, and the transparency in decision making. And I've already intimated in my opening remarks that there are challenges in people having confidence in a verdict that cannot be explained and that is open to interpretation. And the independent Scottish jury research demonstrated that as a verdict, it wasn't understood by jurors, that understanding of it varied. It was sometimes seen as a compromise verdict. It was used if people believed someone was guilty, but there was not enough evidence. And that the evidence also showed that people did believe that the verdict came with associated stigma. So, therefore, if we are moving from a three-verdict system to a two-verdict system, we have to make associated reforms to ensure that we keep a balanced system. And, of course, removing the not-proven verdict is a historic reform. But we have to consider our verdict system in the round between the number of verdicts and, you know, moving from a simple to a qualified majority and also looking at the size of a jury. So our system is in all three counts is very unique. There is no other comparable system. But the overriding message that I would want to convey is that this is about transparency of the decision-making process so that we can have as much confidence in the administration of justice and that our convictions and verdicts command confidence. It is in no way a blunt tool in any shape or form to either increase or decrease convictions.
Thank you. And just on that final point, you mentioned there being no other comparable system where you have three verdicts. Can I ask a wee bit about what happens elsewhere, if you like? Is a two-verdict model a common option in, say, in international models of justice? So looking at what happens in other jurisdictions, particularly sort of in Europe. I'd be quite interested in that.
Yes, I mean, Scotland is an outlier in terms of having a jury of the size of 15 jurors and having three verdicts. And while we are all rightly proud of our very unique Scottish justice system, it is important to stress that our system has always evolved and learnt from others over the centuries, and you know there is no part of our justice system that is exempt from examination or indeed exempt from change.
Okay, thanks for that. Okay, so I'm going to open it up to members, and I'm going to bring in Russell Finlay and then Sharon Dowie. Russell.
Thanks very much. I wonder if it's okay to open with a more general question about the bill. And then one specifically in part four.
That's good.
Thank you. Just to ask, when the bill was first named as the Victims, Witnesses and Justice Reform Scotland Bill, was there an original name for the bill?
I think that would predate my time as Justice Secretary. I don't actually know the answer to that. I don't know if officials can inform if there was another working title. I mean, in general, if I could say that it's not uncommon for legislation when it's been worked on internally to have a holding name and then, you know, for it to be changed. But I don't know if it had different origins.
I think there was a placeholder name, which I think was Criminal Justice Reform Bill. But that obviously evolved to the point where the bill was introduced to Parliament to the current title.
That's the reason I ask. Some victims groups have suggested that this seems like victims was almost an add-on in terms of naming in respect to the content of the bill. which would perhaps be consistent with that. But going to point four, the specific point, will removing not proven and reducing jury sizes have any anticipated impact on conviction rates, and what work has been done to assess this?
Okay. Just in terms of the more general point, convener, I think I would contend that the interests of victims is woven throughout this bill, and in every part of this bill at its core is about improving the experience of victims when they are in contact with the criminal justice system, in recognition that when people become involved as complainers, that is often at a time of trauma, and therefore there are a number of bold but balanced reforms in this bill that reflect that current experience of victims. In terms of Mr Finlay's question in relation to part four of the bill, I won't reiterate what I've said to the convener, that these jury reforms are not about increasing or decreasing convictions. It is about transparency and being able to command the fullest confidence in the administration of justice and all aspects of our justice system. What we know from the very substantial independent Scottish jury research that took place over 2 years. It involved 900 mock jurors, and it was able to isolate factors so that it could consider the very unique aspects of a jury system. So it was specifically able to look at issues of size, majority, and the impact of moving from three verdicts to two verdicts. And they were, in this study, unlike many other studies, were able to really examine the detail of deliberations of the mock jurors. So because it was established that moving from, if you moved from three verdicts to two verdicts in isolation, that could increase convictions, to ensure that there are the appropriate safeguards and balance in our system. And I believe in terms of our consultations responses that there is support to move from a simple majority to a qualified majority.
So just to understand in really sort of simple layman's terms, the Scottish Government's motivation wasn't to improve or change conviction rates, but the studies suggest that would be the likely consequence?
The study suggested that if you change one part of our verdict system, if you move from three verdicts to two verdicts, if you do that in isolation, that would increase the prospect of convictions. And the study demonstrated that it was imperative that you... that the three aspects of our jury system, that they are reformed in tandem, that it's all interrelated, it's the one system.
Which also then show that once you take everything into consideration, there would be no material change to conviction rates?
It showed that you needed to have a balanced approach, that the purpose of the reforms is to maintain confidence in a system, so that is improves the experience of complainers, that the system is transparent and easily understood by everybody. We all have a shared interest in the justice system, but we also have to ensure the integrity of the system and that it's balanced and protects the rights of the accused.
Thank you. I'm still not entirely clear if the changes proposed will actually likely change the conviction rates.
I think I have said repeatedly that these reforms to the jury system are not designed to increase or decrease.
But it's not about the intent, it's about whether the research shows that's a likely consequence, but that's not clear.
I will ask officials to explain the research further to Mr. Finlay in layman terms.
Thanks. Good morning, Convener. The Scottish jury research that the Cabinet Secretary has already explained very clearly found that the structure and the framework of the verdict system, of the jury system, the number of verdicts, the number of jurors and the majority required, those influence outcomes. And so those influence outcomes. So it demonstrated that actually you can't look at them in isolation. You have to consider you have to look at it holistically to consider that if you change that structure in one area, what impact it might have across the board. And the assessment that we've made following the findings of that research and two other studies, independent studies that were referenced in the policy memorandum, was that if you do remove one of the verdicts and finally balance trials, you would increase the likelihood of conviction. So considering that evidence, looking at the structure, the framework in the round, it's our assessment that the other elements have to be adjusted. The Scottish mock jury research also provided very robust evidence in terms of the quality of deliberation for juries in terms of jury size. They looked at 15-member juries and they looked at 12-member juries. And our assessment is that evidence was compelling, that a smaller jury number that exists in many other jurisdictions have juries of 12, would lead to more effective deliberation. It would lead to fewer members of the jury not participating, and then it would lead to fewer sort of dominant jurors. So looking at reducing the jury to 12 and taking the verdicts to two verdicts available, when considering the majority, simple majority as we have now, would obviously be 7 out of 12, whereas we were not satisfied that that actually maintained the balance and the integrity that the Cabinet Secretary has referred to, and a qualified majority moving from 7 out of 12 to 8 out of 12 was appropriate. And that does still recognise the differences in the Scottish legal system compared to many other jurisdictions which require unanimity or close to unanimity. But given the other distinct features of the Scottish system, the assessment is that the package of reform proposed maintains the integrity of the system.
Robert, if I could also add, Convener, just briefly, because I think I'm hoping that this will help get to the nub of Mr. Finlay's question. In terms of the current system, there isn't any data on what individual juries opt for in their decision-making. And no other system has moved from three verdicts to two verdicts, because no other system has three verdicts. So in terms of some of the hypotheses that Mr. Finlay has understandably questioned on, there is no data. It's don't have a crystal ball, but it's the overall balance and integrity of the system that's crucial.
I mean, to recap, there's no intent to change conviction rates with the legislation. The limited data doesn't really tell us, but the best assessment is that this won't have a material change to conviction rates. Is that reasonable?
I think that's a reasonable summary, yes.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. So I'm now going to bring in Sharon Dowie, and then I'll bring in John Swinney. Sharon.
Thank you, Convener. I think Ms. McCloy has actually answered quite a lot of the question that I was going to have. It was more around the reasoning behind changing the jury size. So we're going from 15 to 12 jurors, and before we had 15, where if three stood down or were sick, we could still run with 12, and now we're going to have 12, but we can still run with 9 if three people come off. So I was actually just wondering more about the reasoning behind it, which Ms. McCloy's answered before, but also the other bit about the trial that we're doing, where it would be one judge and a jury for serious sexual offences. So I'm wondering how that would work. So,
can I maybe just ask if you can pause that question, and we'll come to that part of the bill in our next.
Right, okay.
Thank you. Thanks.
I think it is important just to reflect a little bit on history, in that jury size has actually varied over the years. It was much lower than 15 during the Second World War, for example. So it has changed over the decades and at different points in time in history. The core of the evidence is that with reducing from 15 to 12 that you have higher levels of participation and lower levels of members not participating and lower levels of the domination of some members. And in essence, reducing the size is just about, you know, responding to the evidence that says that it improves that process of deliberation. I mean, it isn't really any more complicated than that. And I'll ask Lisa to respond to Ms. Dowie's other question about when, I mean, the qualified majority is sliding and exists in most circumstances when, you know, jurors, you know, perhaps have to be excused, you know, partway through the process, but there are one or two exceptions.
Thanks, Cabinet Secretary. Yes, that's correct. Just now, at the moment, there's 15 members of a jury, but obviously some circumstances arise where a jury member, after being impaneled and after the trial starts, they have to drop out for whatever reason, if they become sick and so on. And just now, the framework allows those trials to continue so long as there's a minimum of 12 jurors that can continue to sit in the case and hear the case. And that's important to avoid unnecessary, rerunning of trials, to avoid unnecessary trauma that would cause to everybody involved, accused, to victims and to witnesses. And it keeps the system going to allow for the fairness of the procedure to be protected, but to keep the administration of justice going. The approach that we've taken in the bill reflects that, and reflects that actually there will be similar circumstances in which trials start and the whole number of jurors aren't able to continue. And again, it allows up to three jurors to fall away and the trial to still continue. It builds in a process of a bit of judicial oversight to make sure that's still in the interests of justice. In our current system, where you have fewer than 15 jurors, you still need an absolute number of 8 to convict. So if, for example, the jury size was to fall to 12, you would need 8 out of 12 remaining jurors to acquit, to convict. And so that actually, you're sort of proportionally increasing the majority required currently as the jury size goes down. The bill takes a slightly different approach and actually maintains the proportion required rather than the absolute number. So it maintains the minimum of 2/3 required where it's 11 or 10 jurors. But where it gets to 9 jurors, that would have taken us to a majority of 6 out of 9. And we felt that actually where it's a smaller number of jurors reaching a verdict, a stronger safeguard was required. So it's 7 out of 9 required in those circumstances. So it broadly reflects current practice, which allows jury numbers to fall after a trial has started, but it changes to maintain the principle of a qualified majority rather than to stick to an absolute number as you have at the moment.
Good. Thanks. Thanks.
Okay, I'm going to bring in John Spinney, followed by Katie Clark.
Thank you very much, Convener. And without doing this every week, can I just remind the committee and those observing that I sat in Cabinet when this bill was constructed, and it's consistent with what I said to the committee in my declaration of interest a couple of weeks ago. But I won't return to that every week we're having this discussion. I wonder if I could just ask about the risk of unintended consequences arising out of the reduction in the jury size, because there will be cases where jurors are judged not to be appropriate to sit in particular trials, people become ill and have to stand down. And I just wonder if there has been consideration given to a potential unintended consequences of reducing the jury size, there being examples of individuals having to step down or falling ill, and getting to a point more regularly in the criminal justice system whereby trials cannot proceed because numbers have become too low in individual trials. And the good intentions of the bill, which are to strengthen the position of victims, to reduce trauma, might inadvertently be put at risk of increased trauma by the fact that in reducing the size of juries from 15 to 12, we might increase the risk of absence or loss of jurors impacting on the effectiveness of the jury system.
Convener, it's a logical question that Mr. Swinney poses. I mean, I'll ask officials to comment. I mean, I'm not aware of the research, you know, throwing up any unintended consequences of that nature. Nor am I aware, but of course I stand to be corrected, that in terms of every other jurisdiction that has a jury size of 12, bearing in mind that Scotland's unusual in having a jury size of 15, that there are you know, significant issues with trials being abandoned because of problems with the jury continuing. But I will, we will of course seek to double check that, but I'm not aware of any concerns.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. And I think that was one of the reasons that we maintained the margin of three. It's currently a margin of three people that are able to fall for a trial to continue. That's one of the reasons that we maintained that, to make sure there wasn't anything unintended. We did speak to partners about this issue, and I don't think there is any data published about it, but it was thought to be quite rare where a trial falls because more than three people currently are unable to continue to serve. But obviously that depends on facts and circumstances, and I'm sure it was a kind of very live issue during the pandemic, for example.
I think, you know, the reason for asking that is obviously the degree of risk of that happening increases if it's 3 out of 15 or 3 out of 12. It becomes a greater degree of risk, and I just wonder if consideration has been given as to the extent to which that may well be a factor in influencing the confidence that people can have that trials will proceed, given the potential turnover of jurors.
Mm-hmm. I mean, it's not been turned up thus far in terms of the deliberations, and, you know, obviously, Mr. Swinney will be aware that the reforms are built on, you know, substantial independent research. But there was also, you know, further, you know, cross-sector work that has been intense in terms of, you know, galvanising and building on the experiences of those that actually work in the operational aspects of our justice system.
Thank you,
Catherine. Thank you very much. So I'll bring in Katie Clark and then Fulton McGregor.
Thank you. And just to be clear, what I think you're saying is that you haven't looked at how many convictions currently are being passed by a simple majority rather than the new two-thirds majority, if you like. Is that the case? You've not actually looked at the real data in real cases and the numbers that have been required for convictions. Is that what you're saying, either in real cases or in mock cases?
So in terms of the jury research, they were able to isolate, hold still some factors so that they could explore, you know, the impact of different majorities, different sizes, you know, moving from three verdicts to two verdicts, or looking at mock juries in the context of three verdicts or two verdicts.
Without having seen any of that and knowing any of that, and we haven't had a lot of detail here, and it may be there is more detail that's not apparent, but without evidence to rebut it, surely if we make it more difficult to get a conviction, which must be the case if you're increasing the proportion of jurors that are required to secure that conviction, that must lead to less convictions. That would be the without looking at it in a huge amount of detail, that must be our presumption, surely.
So, I mean, just to flag, and it may be useful for committee, that the policy memorandum speaks about the jury research in some detail. It's obviously referenced there as well. We have published some information either today or yesterday in and around rape myths, which again talks about this particular research. So just to reassure, you know, committee that there is publicly available information for people to, you know, peruse this further detail. But the point that I was making in reference to the research is that we don't want to change one part of the jury system in isolation, because that may well have unintended consequences, and that's why we're looking at this in the package. So we're following the evidence that was illuminated by the actual research. So this isn't, and I hope I'm understanding Ms. Clark correctly, that, you know, that these are balanced reforms that actually apply to all cases, and, you know, that applies throughout the system. So we have to ensure that there is balance and fairness and integrity, and that we don't have, you know, unintended consequences of changing one part without changing the other constituent parts.
Do you accept that by increasing the proportion required on a jury to secure a conviction, that will make it more difficult to get convictions, and therefore we would expect to see less convictions?
So what I think you've skipped over is that if you move from three verdicts to two verdicts, the evidence shows that juries or mock juries were more likely to convict. Therefore, you have to adapt, move from a simplified to a qualified majority to ensure that there is balance in the verdict system, bearing in mind that this is a cornerstone throughout the system. So these reforms are designed in and around the experiential aspects and transparency and clarity. They are not designed either to increase or decrease. So the change in the majority is to balance the change in the verdicts.
So you're saying that you do believe that changing the majority in isolation would reduce conviction rates, but because other aspects of the changes you believe would increase conviction rates, those two things balance each other out, you think?
That's what the research tells us.
OK. Thank you.
Thanks very much. I'm going to bring in Fulton McGregor and then Rona Mackay, and then we'll move on to the next part of the bill.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, Cabinet Secretary and team. Just a very brief question, because I know a lot's been covered in Part 4 already, and it actually follows on from Katie Clark's line of questioning. I'm interested to understand if the government have got a sort of, maybe priority is the wrong word, but a priority of the reforms and where any lines in the sand may be. And I suppose what I'm asking is, if as this bill's taken through Parliament, either the committee or later the Parliament as a whole decided to amend the bill so that, for example, to abolish a not proven verdict was retained, but going back to a guilty verdict, a simple majority, where would the government stand in that, or does it have to be a whole package?
So I mean, the government's position is that, you know, based on the evidence, we should look at this as a whole package. What the consultation responses were particularly strong about, and actually in a cross-sector approach, whether this was responses from, you know, people who worked within the legal sector, or whether it was victims or their families, is that there was strong support that if you changed from a three verdict system to a two verdict system, that you needed to change the majority from a simple majority to a qualified majority. So if I give you, you know, one example of the importance of that, the Law Society of Scotland are not in favour of abolishing the not proven, but in their evidence they said that if we did, you really need to look at changing the majority. So I think there is a very, as I hopefully I intimated to Ms. Clark, that there is an important relationship, very important relationship, between moving from three verdicts to two verdicts and moving from a simple to a qualified majority.
Okay, thank you. And I'll bring in Rona McCann.
I'll be brief. Good morning. Just to say the not proven verdicts obviously used in some sheriff trials and JP cases where there isn't a jury. So is it the government's view that the removal of the not proven verdict obviously is going to apply there? And would they not need some kind of reform to the way they practice?
No, we don't think so, because obviously it's at summary level it's, you know, the case is presided over by a single judge. I'm sure we'll get onto that later. So there is no jury. So currently, you're quite correct. You know, sheriffs and justice of the peace can use the not proven verdict. It's about 1% of cases where sheriffs or justice of the peace will use the not proven. When it comes to sexual offences, it's 5%. And if you're looking at jury trials, 28% of people who are proceeded against in rape or attempted rape trials will get a not proven verdict.
Thank you. That's good. I just wanted, I mean, from what everything that we've heard, I'm getting this is about fairness and justice and bring us into line with other jurisdictions. So I'm perfectly happy, content with it. Thanks.
Okay, thanks very much. Okay, so I'm just going to move questions on, and I'd like us to move to looking at Part 5 and Part 6 of the bill. So just as a reminder, Part 5 relates to the establishment of a new sexual offences court, and Part 6 has three main provisions. Firstly, the automatic statutory right of anonymity for victims of certain offences. The second is a right to independent legal representation for complainers in sexual offences trials. And the third is to enable a time-limited pilot of single judge trials with no jury for rape and attempted rape cases. So I wonder if I can maybe just open up and pick up on that final provision around single judge trials and the time limited pilot that's being proposed. I'm just wondering if in considering the recommendation made by Lady Dorian, if there were alternative options perhaps considered to that of a single jury trial pilot.
So there was some consideration of other alternative options, convener. Ultimately, the Lady Dorian review, while encompassed a range of opinions, it had settled on a pilot for single judge trial in relation to rape and attempted rape cases on the basis that single judge trials are not novel in Scotland, that actually the majority of criminal cases are presided over by a single judge. I think it's 84% of cases, admittedly for less serious cases and in lower courts. There was certainly both in terms, particularly in terms of the working group that followed post Lady Dorian's extensive review, there was some consideration given to whether you could have a shadow verdict system. So you could have, you know, the judge and jury and then have a shadow judge. However, it was considered there were considerable, you know, ethical issues in and around that. So that was not pursued. There was some consideration given to, you know, more than one judge, you know, perhaps a panel of judges. I suppose some of the practical considerations there is that we don't have an endless supply of judges, and therefore if you, you know, have a situation where there's an appeal, you would, you know, therefore need, you know, a larger panel of judges and so forth. There are, of course, other models in other jurisdictions. You know, the Netherlands, if I'm correct in my recall, have not been, you know, don't use juries. Other jurisdictions have moved away from jury trials for particular cases, you know, parts of Australia, New Zealand, you know, parts of America, France, Germany. They have a judge and also some lay, you know, a panel of lay people. So there are different models, but ultimately the recommendation was to consider a single judge pilot on the basis that this is not novel to Scotland.
Thanks very much. That's really helpful. And just by way of a follow-up, in terms of the sort of aspirations around, you know, the experience for an individual going through a trial relating to rape or sexual offences, would it be possible to, as an alternative option, to achieve what we're aiming to do and improve that experience through almost a non-legislative option? So perhaps improving, for example, trauma-informed training of staff, expanding the use of evidence on commissions so that we're improving and refining what already exists, rather than perhaps looking at a legislative option.
I'm assuming your question is more broadly focused on the bill as opposed to the pilot. So, over the years, a committee such as this will have heard that legislation on its own is never the single bullet. And obviously, it's not that long ago that, as a parliament, we debated, for example, the work that's been done around the trauma-informed skills framework for everybody who works in justice services. But at the core of Lady Dorian's deliberations and recommendations from her work is that, you know, we really need to be making seismic, structural, statutory changes. And of course you'll see that in terms of the statutory changes in the bill, in terms of whether it's the Sexual Offences Court, whether it's the you know, automatic right to independent legal representation, or the automatic rights in and around, you know, anonymity. You know, you can graft on changes and it just becomes quite iterative, it, you know, becomes quite slow, and there is a degree of frustration, you know, both within the legal sector and indeed organisations that represent victims, that for some of these issues that we are debating and you know, discussing in terms of a complainer's experience, in terms of you know, the prevalence and power of rape myths, that we have been, you know, in this territory probably for around 40 years. You know, there has been numerous reports, you know, pointing to the substantive problems. So we now need to, you know, move forward and make substantive changes.
Thank you, that's really helpful. Okay, I'm going to bring in Russell Finlay again and then Sharon Dowie.
Thank you, Convener. My first question is on part five, and it's the policy memorandum talks about staff training, improving case management, improving efficiency, reducing delay, all of which are noble aims. But victims might ask why any of this actually needs legislation, and there's a risk that this might just come across as a very expensive rebranding exercise of the courts. Could you perhaps explain that?
So, while of course, by and large, you don't need legislation to train a workforce, however, you do need legislation to helpfully define what we mean by trauma-informed practice. We do need legislation that puts duties on, you know, court, Crown, police, to ensure that trauma-informed practice is, you know, woven into their standards of service. We do need legislation to establish, you know, a sexual offences court. We do need legislation to establish the rights of complainers when there are Section 275 applications, to ensure that they can access their rights to be heard and their rights to legal representation. So I suppose what I'm trying to indicate, Mr. Finlay, that there are broad platforms of reform that are in this legislation and that need legislation to drive it forward. And of course you'd expect in the policy memorandum to speak about the more cultural aspects that underpin legislative change, and that of course involves training staff.
I mean, some of what you referenced there is part six, for example, legal representation for victims, and you're talking about the need to define trauma-informed, but the legislation doesn't do that. It simply says that the Lord President will decide at a later date what that's going to be. So why can't that just be done by the Lord President or by the courts already without legislation, when the legislation doesn't even specify what it's going to be?
So I would contend that the legislation does have a degree of specificity in and around trauma-informed practice. We do need to recognise that the context of which this will be applied, and we often get to this point in committee debates about, you know, how much Parliament wants to put in the detail of the bill and how much scope that we want to leave for those who have to implement the bill in practice.
Thank you. Now, the next question is in part six. And there's a view that a jury comprising 15 random members of the public, or 12 if the bill goes through, are better at reaching a decision than a Scottish judge alone. They are predominantly late middle-aged white males who went to the same handful of universities, often privately educated, and often live in the same affluent parts of Scotland, usually Edinburgh. Now, it's not me saying that, it's the judges themselves. So do you agree that they are correct in that interpretation, that they would rather have jurors than reliant on one of them?
So the question about diversity is a fair one. I mean, just in terms of balance and fairness, in terms of the contribution made by the senators and their own evidence that they've submitted to committee, that unsurprisingly there is not one view, but of course we've known for some time that there is not one view in and around some of the reforms that are being proposed, particularly in terms of the pilot that has been proposed. And just for the record, it's important to acknowledge that the submission from the senators also narrates that among some senators that there is support for this change. But the point about diversity is an important one. So the jury research that I referred to earlier demonstrated that the diversity of juries did not overcome the prevalence and power of rape myths. And while, of course, Mr. Finlay is right to raise issues about the diversity of the judiciary, nonetheless, with the judiciary, we have a group of professional decision makers who, of course, have experience, who, of course, have training, and who, you know, if they're, you know, part of the sexual offences court, for example, like everybody else, you know, will have to be trauma-informed in terms of the training as well. So it's a more easily identifiable group, you know, to support with other measures in and around education and training, for example, where that is probably unachievable in terms of if you're selecting, 12 people or 15 people on a random basis.
Final, very quick question. Some lawyers have said they're already going to boycott a jurorless trial. What can you do to persuade them? Or will the bill be enacted and you're going to hope for the best?
So, it's of no surprise to me that there are a range of views. I have spent the summer engaging with different bar associations and in particular criminal defence lawyers. I would hope committee would recognise that I am not a politician that only ever wants to meet or engage with people who agree with me. That engagement, from my perspective, was very helpful in terms of understanding better the nature of their particular concerns around the pilot, but also in terms of the other stresses and strains that they are currently experiencing in their day-to-day work. And I think all I would really emphasise, convener, is that no part of our system is exempt from change. I recognise that change can be difficult, it can be challenging, and of course, members of the legal profession are, entitled to their view. They will be, part of that debate. But we have at least a year to go between the start of stage one and by the time we are all voting at stage three and voting on the final bill. I just think we all need to be giving each other a bit of time, a bit of space, having the debate, trying to work together in the interest, because we all share that common goal. We all want guilty people to be convicted and not guilty people to walk free. And we all want the experience that complainers have in our court system to be better. So this is the journey that we're on, Mr. Finlay. I would describe it as more of a marathon than a sprint.
Great. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Good point to end on. Okay, I'll bring in Sharon Dowie and then Rona Mackay.
Thank you again. I suppose following on for that line there, my question was, we have a High Court and a Sheriff Court, so why do we need a new Sexual Offences Court? And the convener actually put it quite well when she said, can we not improve and refine what already exists? So I suppose my question is, how much is it going to be to set up this new Sexual Offences Court? And would that money not be better used to actually go and put the training in and give money to the victim support groups so that we can do it in the system that we've already got?
Thanks. And again, convener, that's another fair question that has, to some extent, been discussed and debated as we introduced the bill. And again, I mean, this comes back to the recommendation from Lady Dorian's review and, that we have over the decades made incremental changes and indeed improvements. But if we want to really embed specialism and to really revamp, policies, processes and practices that are, yes, fair to the accused, but also in the interest of fairness, support complainers to give their very best of evidence, we need to be doing something different. And the concern was that if we were just grafting onto existing structures, that we wouldn't see that fundamental change, that is needed for how we deal with sexual offences cases, which are grown in number. I mean, I think over the past decade or so, they've increased by 275%. I mean, at the start of 2010, 2011, there would be around 80 cases. We are now, looking at the 300 cases. And we have specialism in other parts of the system. So we have specialism in terms of the police who are investigating these complex and highly sensitive cases. And we have prosecutors who specialise in leading the prosecution of these cases. So my question would be, why would we not want our court system to have a court that was also a specialist in these highly emotive, difficult, complex cases that have severe and enduring consequences for victims? So for me, this very much fits with that whole systems approach in improving the end-to-end journey for victims who are pursuing justice.
Right. I still think the money could maybe be better used to upskill all the staff that are already there, but if it were to be passed, can I ask what the timescale would be to get the new court up and running, and do you actually have the resource to go and do it?
So it will be no surprise to anybody in this committee that we are living in fiscally challenging times. I'm not going to go into the reasons or causes for that, or indeed the solutions. That will, of course, be part of a bigger parliamentary budget debate. The cost of establishing the Sexual Offences Court is the one-off costs are a minimum of £1.4 million, and we'll be looking at a minimum of £500,000 per annum going forward. I think it is fair to say that those costs may change depending on the operational decisions in terms of how we go forward in terms of the implementation. And in terms of timescale, so this bill, if it passes, that's a year away, and the measures that would be implemented first in 2025 are likely to be the measures where you don't require secondary legislation or court rules, and obviously in terms of establishing a sexual offence court, you know, there would be new court rules and procedures that would have to be put in place as well. So we are still a wee bit off from achieving the ambitions in and around a sexual offences court. And as with any bill, particularly a very large bill, in terms of not overwhelming the current system, all of that does have to be phased in. But the other crucial, and that's where I'll end on this point, Convener, I'm surprised you're not telling me to cut to the chase. I think the other crucial reason and the other crucial argument and potential benefit of a sexual offences court is actually it could improve efficiency in terms of dealing with this, you know, growing number of complex cases. So again, this was something that the Lady Dorian review looked at, that you know, that a large part of her work was actually what measures, additional measures, can we assist with the efficiency of cases, bearing in mind that, yes, you know, there is still a court recovery programme, but this measure is also an opportunity to be dealing with these cases more efficiently.
Okay, and a final one. You'd actually said earlier on that we all have an aim for guilty to be convicted and not guilty to be set free, which I'm sure we'll all agree on. But one of the things that victims have said, and we're saying we want victims' voices to be heard, it's at the end they feel let down because of the sentence. So is the bill looking at anything to do with sentencing for people that are actually convicted of an offence?
So the bill doesn't deal with sentencing policy. The bill is responding to the experience of victims in the criminal justice system. I understand perfectly the point that Ms. Dowie is making. But we also know from victims that, and particularly in terms of the personal testimony of victims who've been through the system, that experience is sometimes as important as the outcome. And if we're having a system that re-traumatises victims. That is not in the interest of justice, that is not in the interest of access to justice, and it will not encourage or support victims to come forward. But the bill is as it stands, and it makes no reference to sentencing policy.
Okay, thank you. Okay, I'll bring in Rona Mackay, followed by John Swinney.
Thank you. Yeah, just sort of following on from that line of questioning about why sexual offence courses are needed, I distinctly remember the Lord Advocate Dorothy Bain saying at the start of Session 6 that to improve justice for women and girls who are victims of sexual violence, radical reform is needed. And I really do think that's what we're doing here. So my question is really relating to Part 6 of the bill, and it's about the current approach to anonymity. Could you maybe outline why you think the current approach should be replaced by a statutory protection for victims?
So the current approach is more about practice and protocol. It's a non-statutory approach. So right now the mainstream press abide and adhere to a non-statutory approach, and they need to be, you know, commended for that. But we're now in a world of social media, which is massive, with a massive reach and an absolutely phenomenal number of contributors who, at the click of a button, can share all sorts of information. But fundamentally, we want more clarity and certainty for complainers, again, so that they have the confidence to report and the automatic assurance that their privacy and dignity will be protected.
Yeah, thank you. I mean, that sort of leads me on to my next question about legal representation and the current provisions, you know, regarding the restricting the use of sexual history and character evidence really don't provide adequate protection. So I wonder if you could expand on that our plans to provide independent legal representation to try and address those problems.
So, again, the evidence for this comes from the Victims Task Force, from the consultations that the government has undertaken, and of course Lady Dorian's review. And the current situation is that under common law, complainers who are part of a rape trial have rights to be involved, but in terms of how they are exercised, currently that would fall to the Crown Office. And that's not satisfactory in that it's the job of prosecutors to prosecute in the public interest. And the public interest is different from the interest of complainers. And in terms of the Section 275 applications that are led to get permission of the court to lead evidence that is often very sensitive and intrusive matters. It's often referred to as the section to enable people to go into someone's character or indeed their past history, including their past sexual history, and that of course is deeply intrusive. And as the process starts, there is no opportunity for the victim to be represented or for their views on that application process to be heard. So the independent legal representation is to ensure, again, that there is parity, that there is opportunity, that there is fairness for victims to express their view about these particular applications, and for them also to have the right of appeal.
Thank you. Thank you, Convener.
Thanks very much. I'll bring in John Swinney and then Katie Clark.
Thank you, Convener. I'm interested in the linkage between the provisions in the bill on trauma-informed practice and these particular provisions in parts 5 and 6. And I'm struck that in section 43.4, and forgive me, Convener, for being specific here, the bill talks about carrying out the responsibility imposed. The President must have regard to the desirability of doing so in a way that accords with trauma-informed practice. And what I'm keen to understand is how satisfied the Government is that the provisions of the bill will actually result in a genuinely more trauma-informed experience for victims. Because I take the point that Sharon Dowie is asking about, well, couldn't we just do this through our existing court system? I tend to come to the view that the existing court system is, you know, so cumbersome, so heavily laden with procedure, that it is difficult to adapt. So I'm interested in the thinking that has gone in to ensure that we can be satisfied that the Sexual Offences Court would operate in a more trauma-informed way than an adaptation of the existing court arrangements in Scotland.
So, Mr Swinney and other members are quite correct to, in their question, actually encapsulate what Lady Dorian expressed, that the adoption of trauma-informed practices is central. It's absolutely central to the experience of complainers, and it's central to how we can improve the experiences of complainers. And of course, the bill does this in a number of ways, and Mr. Swinney's quoted for 43, but this, the levers that the bill takes is that it creates that statutory definition of trauma-informed practice. It requires justice agencies to have regard to trauma-informed practices and their work with victims and witnesses, and empowers the courts to set rules and procedures on trauma-informed practice in relation to both criminal and civil businesses. And I suppose the practical application of that is, to take trauma-informed practice into account when they're scheduling court business. In terms of the sexual offences courts, it's, moving to that presumption around pre-recorded evidence, which obviously there is, some legislation right now in and around virtual trials. And it's, to get to the heart of the manner to improve the experience and the efficiency, without trying to tweak around the edges. And the Sexual Offences Court is a real opportunity. I think it's an unrivalled opportunity to embed expertise and to take that, and I'm sure it was Lady Dorian that described it as that clean sheet approach, instead of guddling about in an existing system that is not satisfactory to many complainers and is re-traumatising complainers, that actually take a clean sheet. What do we need to do differently? Let's build this from the ground up.
I appreciate that answer. Can I follow it up then with one of the areas which I suspect contributes significantly to trauma is timescales and the amount of time that a victim has to wait for the process to reach some form of conclusion. Does the government believe that the bill, as it's drafted just now, has places sufficient obligation on improving the timescale for the handling of such cases as part of doing what I completely accept from the Cabinet Secretary's explanation, is the underpinning thinking of ensuring that trauma-informed practice is applied in all circumstances?
So right now I do, but of course the purpose of scrutiny is to shine a light on areas that can be improved, or to unravel any knots that is in legislation. I mean, I'm very undefensive about these things, that the main priority between now and this bill passing is to ensure that we have the best legislation possible. And I'm sure, again, we all want to see this as we embark upon this journey together, that we work together to improve the bill. I mean, the rationale of having a specialist sexual offences court is about improving the efficiency of the process as well, because we know the traumatic impact that delays. There are a range of operational matters that will need to be addressed. So, for example, in terms of independent legal representation, to ensure people can access their rights timeously without, adding further delays. So there is a lot of detail to be worked through, and a lot of detail that underpins this bill. But the purpose of, or one of the purposes of a sexual offences court is to improve efficiency. And that was, in many ways, the starting point, or one of the starting points for Lady Dorian's work, is that we have an increasing volume of cases. How are we going to deal with these more efficiently? Because that's not just in the interest of the court system. That's fundamentally in the interest of victims. I don't know if officials, if there's anything I've missed out or not addressed.
No, I don't think so. I think the only other thing perhaps to mention is in Lady Dorian's report, when they're recommending the court, one of the focus they put on is a specialist court, a specialist environment could really encourage stronger sort of active judicial management of processes, and that would include pre-trial processes as well as the trial itself, which may lead to seeing improvements in unnecessary sort of churn of cases or adjournment of cases. And then there's also the point that Cabinet Secretary made there about pre-recording evidence and bringing witnesses in advance of trial to shorten that particular part of the journey, whilst I appreciate that they still have an interest in the outcome of the journey. And I suppose in terms of the whole approach of the court of being more compassionate, being a more specialist environment to keep witnesses more engaged, to perhaps reduce to some of the other causes of churn in the system.
Just on that point, there's a lot of hope and aspiration in the comments that Ms McCloy has just put on the record there. I'm quite interested to make sure that it actually is turned into practical reality, and that we don't actually just create a sexual offences court which looks awfully similar to existing courts, because I'm interested in how we are able to oblige that to happen.
That's why we have to ensure that the bill will deliver and be implemented on its aspirations. The devil is always in the detail, and it's always what happens on the ground.
Thank you. My last question is that one of the other elements of the court process that we haven't talked about so far is the conduct of the defence. And I unreservedly accept the points in the policy memorandum about the importance of balance, about the protection of the right to justice within this. But I can't be the only person horrified by the conduct of some defence solicitors in the way in which these matters are pursued within court. So the government can bring forward a bill here which does all it possibly can do to improve and to apply trauma-informed practice to the conduct of a consideration of cases of alleged sexual crime. But what obligations will the defence be under? Or what approaches can be taken to ensure that some of the behaviour that horrifies many of us in the courts of our land is not replicated in the Sexual Offences Court.
And I think we've all heard very powerful personal testimony of complainers' experiences in court, in sexual offence cases in particular. We have also seen the observations of Lady Dorian and her work, where she reflected on some of the commentary by the appeal court and some of these matters in terms of intrusive and unnecessary questioning. I will just for the record say that criminal defence lawyers are an invaluable part of our system, and that we do indeed need to be making transformational changes on improving the experience of complainers going through the process. But our aim is always to ensure that we don't, in doing so, have the unintended consequences of cutting across the rights of the accused. And the Sexual Offences Court, and I think where it has the opportunity to be transformational, is that everybody who participates in that Sexual Offences Court has to be trauma-informed and underwent trauma-informed training. So there is an opportunity to create a very different court environment. I actually would contend, and I speak as a former prison social worker here, and you know, I'm very open about the fact that I have worked with more offenders than victims. Worked with both, but I've worked with more offenders over my time, and have, you know, advocated for fairness and justice for those accused, or indeed those convicted. But I think the real prize in a sexual offences court is that it has benefits potentially for everybody, both the complainer and the accused, and moves us away from an adversarial system to one that is more deliberative, better managed, more inquisitorial, absolutely testing the evidence robustly and fairly, but does not disregard the welfare of those participating in that process. So there's a real prize here, and there's a real opportunity for everybody to work together on this journey that is in the interest of a justice system in Scotland that is bold, but is, and it's brave, but it's also fair and balanced.
Thank you.
I'm bringing Katie Clark and then Fulton McGregor.
Thank you. And the figure of a minimum of £1.4 million was mentioned in relation to the pilot. So how many cases is that based? Sexual offences.
Not the pilot.
So the £1.4 million is, but my understanding is that the Sexual Offences Court won't deal with all sexual offences in Scotland in the first instance. Is that correct? And is the £1.4 million the additional cost of the court, or the total cost of the court? And how many cases or places is that figure based on? Just to get a bit more understanding in terms of what is actually being proposed. I do have another question, but it may be that the Cabinet Secretary wants to answer.
So obviously right now there is a cost to addressing and responding to the demand, the increasing demand on sexual offences cases. So in terms of the Sexual Offences Court, this is looking at the additional costs that are specific to the changes that are proposed. Now, that figure may, of course, change depending on some of the operational decisions in and around that, in terms of, you know, the court rules being one example. And the purpose of the Sexual Offences Court is to deal with it has unlimited sentencing power, so it can be dealing with a wide variety of cases. But its sentencing powers are unlimited, and it's important to put that on record in that it will have maximum sentencing powers, but will be able to deal with a broad range of cases. In terms of numbers, I mean, we know that there's an increasing number of solemn cases, but in terms of the actual numbers and the category of cases that will go to the Sexual Offences Court, do we have some further information on that?
Yes, certainly. When preparing the financial memorandum, we obviously worked with partners to try and identify the numbers of cases that might be caught under the jurisdiction of the new court, which is seeking to capture all solemn-level sexual offending, so bringing cases together from the Sheriff Courts as well as the High Court. But the bill is not prescriptive. It gives prosecutors a choice of, as you said, Ms Clark, it doesn't require sexual offences to be prosecuted in these courts, but it is a choice open to prosecutors. So it's difficult to model exactly what the caseload might be for the court, but the bill in itself and the creation of the court won't create new cases. It's about redistributing the existing caseload within the system just now into a more sort of focused trauma-informed forum. So the figures that we quoted within the financial memorandum, and we'll continue to develop those sort of predictions with partners, were that based on the last sort of 3 years of good data we had, it we might see up to 700 cases in the sexual offences courts.
That's very helpful. And Russell Finlay spoke about the demographic of those that sit in judgment, the judges, and I just wonder, in terms of the selection criteria for the new Sexual Offences Court, what thought has given to how people will be selected to be judges and what the demographic is likely to be?
So that will be for the Head of Judiciary, Lord Justice General. And again, it's important that we're clear about that. And the Lord Justice General will be able to, appoint, across the field, and will be able to appoint sheriffs to this court, as well as judges, and will be able to do so on the basis of people's experience, their expertise and their training.
Would it be acceptable if I ask a question in relation to Part 6, Convener?
Yes, of course. Just conscious of the time, so I'm going to that's fine, and then I'll bring in Fulton McGregor, and I've got a couple of follow-up questions myself, so we might just run on an extra 5 minutes or so, but yes, please do.
Full to that, and I've spoken with the Cabinet Secretary previously about the independent legal representation of victims in other jurisdictions, and there's obviously very specific and narrow provision in this bill in relation to independent legal representation of rape victims. And I just wondered whether the Scottish Government is willing to further explore a pilot or pilots in relation to independent legal representation of victims, in particular rape victims, both before the court process and during the court process, whether that's something that might be considered in the context of this bill or indeed as a separate discussion.
Well, Convener, known from my previous discussions with Ms Clark, I have no doubts that we'll be debating this matter further. I know Ms Clark has shared with me some very interesting research, different models from elsewhere, and I have no doubt that she'll continue to press me every stage of this bill on these matters. In terms of our approach taken thus far, and our position right now, this is a substantive change. The model in terms of the automatic legal representation and how complainers access that timeously is still being developed. We're working with a range of justice partners, and there is obviously the work of the Emma Rich Clinic as well, because we do need to get this. It is a substantive change, And it will be a demand-led change, so estimating the cost of it is somewhat challenging when it will be, you know, down to it'll be, you know, a demand-led budget. So right now I have some caution because it's you know, we're living in the reality of resource implications, but it also goes back to one of the points raised earlier is about how we ensure that we deliver. And I do think in terms of the proposition right now that the focus should be on delivering that in a way that is accessible and supports women to have their voice heard, but to do so in a way that, you know, could potentially be, you know, a platform for further change and further reform. But given the importance of implementing legislation and the importance of bearing in mind costs, I have, you know, a significant degree of caution right now, but look forward to hearing more and that sharing of other experiences and evidence from further afield, because I do think it's important.
Thank you, and I'll bring in Fulton McGregor.
My questions are around Part 6 and anonymity for victims. I'm just wondering, Cabinet Secretary, if I can ask you to outline what you think the advantages will be for changing the current approach of anonymity for victims of sexual offences and replacing it by a statutory protection as outlined in the bill.
It's to seek clarity and certainty for complainers at the earliest opportunity. It's to increase the confidence for people to come forward and to report and to make complaints in the first place. I mean, we all know the evidence that sexual offences in particular are underreported, and having security of anonymity is part of increasing people's confidence to come forward. And the clarity is important, that it just automatically starts, that there is no process for people to go through. It is automatic from the time of the offence. There's been significant research and thought given to this, and I could point to the work of Andrew Tickell and his colleagues and students at Glasgow Caledonian University that have very much, you know, led, you know, much of the campaign in terms of automatic lifelong anonymity. And it's recognising that for particular sexual offences, but also offences to do with FGM, human trafficking, and other very sensitive offences that have a particular bearing on people's physical integrity and their privacy, that we have a system that supports the confidence of that system, but also supports people to come forward to make reports in the first place.
Thanks, Cabinet Secretary. I very much welcome this provision in the bill. I wanted to ask as well if there was any consideration given to the possibility of extending anonymity to accused persons. I know this is a much more difficult area, but something that struck me about the debate, the Criminal Justice Committee debate that we had in Parliament last week, there was some discussion on the impact of these offences when somebody's accused on other family members. It was actually quite powerfully put by members in the chamber last week. So the person is an accused person, but also their family are also impacted by what are often very serious concerns, serious accusations, and they are often, more often than not, innocent parties. So I wonder if the government had given any consideration to the extending of anonymity.
We have not considered it. We've not consulted on it. It was not part of the Lady Dorian review or any of the recommendations that flowed from that. And we have not explored in any way that would look at the unintended consequences. I suppose I would say that one of the advantages of removing the not proven verdict is that in a two-verdict system, people are either guilty or not guilty. And if someone's found not guilty, I think that is clear and unambiguous.
Thanks. Thank you.
Okay, thanks very much. I wonder if I can just finish off this particular section with a question. It's also about the position of an accused person, but it's in relation to the pilot proposal and whether or not it would be mandatory for an accused person sort of falling within the scope of the pilot to essentially participate, and whether you feel that there might be sort of a sort of problematic sort of response to that.
So the Lady Dorian Review was silent on that matter. The working group that flowed from her work, again, it was cross-sectoral, opted for the position, and it's currently the government's position that it is mandatory for the cases and for the accused, in the same way that it would be mandatory for the complainer. I suppose in terms of how the justice system operates more broadly, the accused doesn't decide which court or which level of court or which procedure is currently used for their case. So that's our position. And the other practical aspect of it, where we seek Parliament's consent to introduce regulation to have a time-limited pilot. Any effective pilot will require, a particular number of cases as well, particularly if it's to be time-limited.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. That's helpful clarification. OK, I'm going to move us on to the final part, you'll be glad to hear, of our session today, looking at parts 1 to 3 of the bill and looking at around about 25 minutes or so on that. So just a reminder, part 1 relates to the establishment of a Victims and Witnesses Commissioner. Part 2 relates to a new requirement for criminal justice agencies to have regard to trauma-informed practice. And part 3 relates to special measures in non-evidential hearings to cover civil cases and allowing the court to prohibit parties from personally conducting their own case and carrying out personal cross-examination in certain cases. So, again, if I can maybe just open up with a question around the proposals for a Victims and Witnesses Commissioner. We've heard general support for this particular proposal. However, I think the two things that I've picked up around that have been potentially the cost implications and also the role of a commissioner, given that the proposal is that they would not have a role in the investigation or review of individual cases. So just ask the Cabinet Secretary just expand a little bit more on the thinking around this particular proposal.
So it's an issue in which the government has been engaging with stakeholders since around 2019, and in particular on the role of a Victims and Witness Commissioner. There is broad support for this in the consultation responses, and there is clearly a demand for it from victims and victims' organisations, although I would hasten to add that you wouldn't expect unanimity of views, that's for sure. And the purpose is to have an independent statutory commissioner that's accountable to Parliament. And it's to complement and not duplicate the role of, for example, victims organisations. And, of course, in terms of, I think you mentioned the issue of funding. I mean, we currently separately, you know, invest, you know, heavily in victims' organisations, whether that's through the Victim Centred Approach Fund at £48 million or whether it's the Equally Safe Fund of £19 million. And, you know, the costs of establishing a Victims and Witness Commissioner is laid out in the financial memorandum, and, you know, no financial cost is insignificant, but, you know, they are far less substantial than the amount that we currently and will continue to invest in victims' organisations.
And just picking up on that point about sort of potential sort of duplication of work that's perhaps already the focus of victim support organisations, would there be some work undertaken to make sure that there isn't a duplication and that are quite clear and distinct sort of roles and responsibilities within, say, the commissioner role, obviously organisations representing victims, so that there's a sort of holistic support provision, if you like, in and around victims and witnesses?
So, I mean, this touches on the point that the Commissioner won't have the power to intervene on individual cases. They can, of course, you know, signpost and, you know, will engage with victims and witnesses either individually or collectively. I mean, the purpose of a commissioner is to hold the justice system collectively to account. You would expect them to work very closely and carefully with other commissioners. You don't want the duplication of, you know, particularly in and around children would be the obvious example. And the role here is to identify and influence systems wide change. So it's more about holding the system to account, and I think therefore, you know, avoiding duplication with the other roles that other organisations fulfil.
Thank you very much. I'm aware we did cover some of the provisions in parts 1 to 3 and some of our earlier questioning around, for example, trauma-informed practice. Are there any other questions that members would like to come in on about? Rona McCann.
Thank you. I just wanted to ask about the issue of more alignment between the treatment vulnerable witnesses get in civil and in criminal courts. Scottish Women's Aid have highlighted this as a concern in their submission, and I just wondered if this is something that could be worked on as the bill's going through and looked at, or how much of a concern do you have over the...
So, Ms McCann is quite right to say that part 3 of the bill is to increase those safeguards for vulnerable parties and witnesses in civil cases, you know, extending the use of special measures and essentially protecting people that have suffered abuse from being cross-examined by the accused abuser. And that speaks to all the evidence that we've heard, over a number of years, that people often feel less protected in the civil system, particularly where, in terms of, you know, family cases, other civil procedures, when domestic violence can be a feature. So I think the extension of the special measures in this bill is an important step forward. I think it's a significant step forward, and moves on from other, you know, comparatively recent legislation where special measures were enabled for, you know, quite a specific selection of family cases that this is actually applying best practice across the civil system.
So this kind of complements the measures in the Children's Scotland Bill and will strengthen protection for vulnerable witnesses.
Take them further. Okay. Much more comprehensive.
Okay, thank you.
Thanks. Okay, thank you. I'll bring in John Swinney, then Russell Finlay.
Thanks, Kavira. I'm interested in what consideration has been given to essentially providing greater obligation within statute in the bill on organisations to take account of the perspective of victims rather than establishing a victims commissioner. Because it strikes me in reading the provisions on victims commissioner, having said that, for completely understandable reasons, that the victims commissioner cannot look at individual cases, but they can look at kind of general conclusions arising out of particular cases or groups of cases. Isn't there an alternative approach, which is to put greater legal obligation on the various agencies that are involved here in acting in a manner that reflects the perspective and the interests of victims?
Well, I mean, if Mr. Swinney has specific propositions to strengthen the bill in terms of strengthening the obligations on various actors and agencies who have a responsibility towards victims, we'll certainly look forward to receiving those. I suppose just, you know, right now in terms of where we are, I think this is a belt and braces approach. I also I'm very conscious that I have a manifesto commitment to deliver as well in and around a victims and witness commissioner too. But of course, for committee, an independent committee will come to its own views and will make its own recommendations, which I can assure Mr. Swinney and the convener and indeed all other members that all recommendations will be given a very fair hearing.
Thank you.
And Russell Finlay, then Sharon Dowie.
Yes, thanks very much. I've got two questions. The first one relates to part one, the Victims Commissioner, and the second relates to part three. The part one, we've got evidence to the committee from Joe Duffy, who's the father of Amanda Duffy, who was murdered many years ago, and he's campaigned tirelessly to see the end of the not proven verdict, but also within his submission he made some comments about the creation of a victims commissioner, and indeed he's opposed to the creation. And what he says in his submission is, the creation of this post will create yet another level of unnecessary bureaucracy within the criminal justice process. There are limited funding and resources currently within Criminal Justice Scotland, and we believe this appointment will adversely impact resources. And he goes on to say a bit more along those lines. So I just wondered what you would say in response to him and others who share those concerns.
Now, I did reflect earlier, Mr. Finlay, that while this is very broadly supported, there's been a lot of active campaigning on the introduction of a specific victims and witness commissioner, that, you know, there is never unanimity amongst any group. I've met Mr. Duffy not that long ago, actually. I suppose I would refer back to my earlier comments. As a government, we have and we continue to invest very heavily in victims' organisations, whether that's through Equally Safe, whether that's through the victim-centred approach fund, which sits at £48 million. And, of course, it's the job of Parliament to hold government to account in terms of what we're investing in victims' organisations and for government and ministers such as I to explain where we're investing the resource. But I hope to convey to committee that when you look at a £48 million victim-centred approach fund, £19 million for Equally Safe, that the costs for establishing and the ongoing costs for a victims commissioner are not insignificant, but small in comparison.
Thank you very much. Now, part three, relating to special measures in civil cases. We've heard evidence in the committee of cases in which male abusers have used the civil courts in tandem with criminal proceedings to inflict further harm and abuse to their victims. One suggestion that was made to us by various victims groups was that a single sheriff model could be brought into force, whereby if there were tandem criminal and civil cases, they could be heard by one sheriff who'd be across all of it and would be aware of this going on. I just wonder if any consideration was given to any form of reform in that respect and whether there might be scope to do so going forward, even within this bill.
Sorry, you have to forgive me, Mr. Finlay. I'm just trying to operationalise in my head how that would actually work in practice.
What the evidence we heard would be, so if, for example, an individual was facing criminal proceedings relating to of a domestic or sexual nature, and in tandem, as there is often the case, there's civil cases relating to custody or access involving children, some of the evidence we heard suggested that you could overcome this competing, often, and further traumatising process by having one sheriff deal with both those sets of proceedings, civil and criminal.
Not commenting on the merits of that or otherwise, and I can see I can see there's a logic to it in terms of efficiency and fairness, but I have certainly not been cited or been involved in any deliberations in and around that. But it would appear that it is an issue of interest, so we will take an interest in it. I don't know if officials have anything to add from a practical level.
I think just to say, policy colleagues in Civil Justice Division within government, I think that has been an issue that's been raised, obviously, by the same stakeholders with them, and something that colleagues have had some discussion with SCTS about. As the Cabinet Secretary was kind of alluding to there, there are obviously operational issues that might make that quite difficult, but it is an issue that's been subject to discussion. I don't think those discussions are obviously at a level where we would be looking to bring forward legislative proposals at this time, but it is something that is being considered alongside the broader point about the potential for the dual role of civil and criminal cases running concurrently to add to the trauma of families.
Given this is the legislation in this term of Parliament that's going to deal with court processes and victims, it seems like a possible opportunity, and I'd be happy to see if there's a way of working on a possible amendment to bring that in. It seems, given all the radical reform that is being proposed, this could be quite a simple fix, whereby if there was a criminal case with an associated civil case, by virtue of the court just recognising that and bringing it into being, it doesn't sound particularly difficult. But
Convener, I mean, we're always in the art of the willing and will want to engage with members collectively and individually about the causes that are dear to their heart. I suppose my one word of caution is that when people say this will be simple, it invariably, it usually never is simple. However, but we're always more than happy to have discussions, and I'm sure members will be testing the scope of the legislation in front of us as well.
Thank you.
And finally, Katie Clark.
Just very briefly, and for the record, what do you envisage the cost of the Victims Commissioner being?
So it is around £600,000 start-up and £600,000 recurrent costs. It's a little bit over that. It's between, it's maybe like, it's between £600,000 and £650,000.
Thank you.
I'll, if you bear with me. If you bear with me. Yep. And it is. So one-off costs up to £638,719. Recurring costs up to £615,149.
Couldn't that be an annual cost? Yes.
Yeah, the recurring cost.
Yes, thank you.
Thank you, and my apologies to Sharon Dowie. I jumped ahead, so he'd like to come in.
No problem, thank you. And following on from Katie Clark's question there, on the set-up costs and the recurring costs, do you think this is going to provide value for money, and what is it that the Commissioner is going to do to improve the situation for victims and witnesses?
So it is of course absolutely fair and legitimate to be scrutinising the costs of establishing a new Commissioner role. I'm conscious that in Parliament today we'll be debating and voting on a patient safety commissioner, and I suppose if I'm reflecting on discussions and representations that victims have made to me, is that they feel that there are a range of commissioners but there isn't one for victims and witnesses. And as I indicated earlier, I mean, the purpose of a Victims and Witness Commissioner is to scrutinise and hold the justice system to account in and around the implementation, for example, of the service standards of justice agencies, but also in terms of the Victims Code. And they will be able to, they'll be required to be publishing a report and their findings and to make recommendations for improvements and to lay that report in Parliament.
OK, so just the comment you said there about there's a range of commissioners and they hold the system to account, but have you done any assessment on whether the other commissioners are actually effective in the role that, you know, they've got a commissioner, so we want one. Are the commissioners being effective? Because even though they're accountable to Parliament, we've already got a Cabinet Secretary and a Minister that are accountable to Parliament. So why do we need to bring in another layer of bureaucracy?
So, I mean, that is a broader debate. I obviously haven't been intimately involved in evaluating the role and function and effectiveness and the contribution of the wide range of commissioners that exist. I do, in terms of my experience, either as a minister or as an MSP, you know, I would be clear that the commissioners that I have observed more or had more dealings with, for example, the Children's Commissioner, for example, has held us all to account very effectively at different points and junctures. And I suppose, you know, and I accept entirely the point you make about the primacy of parliamentary scrutiny and parliamentary scrutiny of ministers, and, you know, the role and function of commissioners doesn't in any way undermine, and it certainly doesn't replace any of that. That's for sure. But it is about what more can they bring in terms of expertise and insight to the system as a whole. And quite often, the findings that commissioners come forward with, quite often, again in my experience, aid MSPs to hold the government to account as well. So I suppose it's about a plurality of the system is what I'm driving at.
So again, we've got a lot of groups out there, including victim support, that already deal with the victims, and are we not listening to their voice? So are they not able to come and bring all the issues with the system to us so that we can hear them? I'm just thinking about when it comes down to the cost. So would that money not better be placed given to more groups? And that brings me on to another question. Where is the money coming from? Is something else getting cut to provide this money for another commissioner?
So notwithstanding that some victims and organisations have a different view about the value of a victims and witness commissioner, in terms of the consultation and the representation that we have received over a number of years, it would appear to me that the biggest advocates for a victims and witness commissioner is actually victims themselves. And the point about the cost, I mean, I've put on record the cost, and of course people will scrutinise that and come to a view on whether that money should be used to establish a victims commissioner, or indeed whether, as individual MSPs, parties or committees, could you come to a view that that money should be better spent elsewhere, you will of course be free to do that. I of course have outlined the investment that we continue to make in victims' organisations.
Yeah, it's not an insignificant amount of money. And just one final question on implementation. You obviously said that we're bringing in this bill, we want to make the system more efficient. Just in part three, it's got a part in with the Children's Scotland Act 2020. It's sections 48 of the Children's Scotland Act aim to address some of the weaknesses in the 2004 Act. However, these provisions are not yet in force. So I'm just wondering if this was an act that was passed, it was the 2020 Act, why is it not being enforced yet?
So it's a piece of legislation that the implementation of which was interrupted by the pandemic. And meantime, we've come forward with a bill with more extensive protections to place in the civil system as a whole, whereas the particular legislation that you're referring to was pretty bespoke in and around some family cases. So actually this bill will deliver more, and therefore you know, that's where my focus is delivering more with maximum impact.
Okay, thank you very much indeed. So that brings us neatly round to our close. So can I thank the Cabinet Secretary and our officials for attending today? I think that's been an extremely helpful session, and that completes our public agenda item. At next week's meeting, we'll start our first phase of evidence taking on the bill, covering parts 1 to 3, and we'll hear from organisations representing victims of crime as well as the third sector. So again, my thanks, and we'll now move into private session. Thank you.